But the ministry ushers in the presence of the Holy Ghost. And right now, even before I preach or say anything, I know that God is already moving and touching people. And whatever situation you came in with, you will not leave with that situation. Because of the anointing that destroys the yoke. Give God praise. Give Him glory. Hallelujah. Give Him glory. Hallelujah. Well, good afternoon, Zion. Amen. We give God praise. We give Him honor. We give Him glory. You know, I have to move from one anointing into another, you know. It's taking me just a minute. I'm getting there. Hallelujah. Y'all pray for the Reverend this morning. Blessed be the name of Jesus. He's worthy to be praised. He's worthy to be honored. He's worthy to be glorified. Worship Him, worship Him, worship Him. For the Lord is good, and His mercy endures forever. Amen. As always, it's a privilege and a pleasure to minister before the home folks. Amen. And the other thing about it, it is also, amen, a responsibility. Because I'm standing in front of a church full of people that read their Bible. I just believe that. And so when you come to a service, you are coming to receive meat. And by the aid of the Holy Ghost, you know, I'm going to endeavor to give you meat because you're used to that every week. I say that, you know, maybe with a little bias, but I just believe that every service that you come in, that the Lord releases a word that will be deposited on the inside that will make a difference. You may not run and jump and shout every week, but you're going to leave here with a deposit. Amen. Well, we give God praise, and we want to go ahead and get into the Word of God this morning. Yes. Are you guys ready for the Word? Yes. Amen. I believe that. Let's go to the book of Mark, and as you can follow on your screen, and if you would stand in reverence of the Word this morning, we give God praise and honor, but we also revere His Word. Hallelujah. Amen. You know, the screen is there to, for our convenience, but not to replace the written word. So don't go to church and leave your Bibles at home. Amen. But we give God praise for technology. Amen. Mark 9, verse 14. And when he came to his disciples, he saw a great multitude about them, and the scribes questioning them. And straightway all the people, when they beheld him, were greatly amazed, and running to him, saluted him. And he asked of the scribes, what question ye with them? One of the multitude answered and said, Master, I have brought unto thee my son, which hath a dumb spirit. And whatsoever he taketh him, he teareth him, and he foameth and gnasheth with his teeth, and pineth away. And I spake to thy disciples that they should cast him out, and they could not. He answered them and said, O faithless generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I suffer you? Bring him unto me. And they brought him unto him, and when he saw him, straightway the spirit tear him, and he fell on the ground, and wallowing, foaming. And he asked his father, how long is it ago since this child, since this came upon him? And he said, of a child. And oftentimes it hath cast him into the fire and into the waters to destroy him. But if thou canst do anything, have compassion on us and help us. Jesus said unto him, if thou canst believe, all things are possible to him that believeth. And straightway the father of the child cried out and said with tears, Lord, I believe, help thou mine unbelief. When Jesus saw that the people came running together, he rebuked the foul spirit, saying unto him, thou deaf, dumb and deaf spirit, I charge thee, come out of him and enter no more into him, and the spirit cried and rent him sore and came out of him, and he was as one dead, insomuch that many said, he is dead. But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him up, and he arose. And when he was come into the house, his disciples asked him privately, why could we not cast him out? And he said unto them, this kind can come forth by nothing but by fasting and prayer. Let's bow our heads. Father, in Jesus' name, we do indeed give you praise and honor and glory for your word today. We praise you for the teacher who is the Holy Spirit, who guides us in all truth and shows us things to come. Holy Spirit, teach today. And I pray and decree and declare that our ears are anointed to hear what thus saith the Lord. And as always, we pray that we will be doers of the word that we hear and not hearers only. I take authority over everything that would seek to distract from the receptivity of the word today. And in the name of Jesus, we give you praise for your presence here now. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. You may be seated. And ushers, you may be seated as you will. Amen. Today we're going to come from the subject, if you can believe. If you can believe. Amen. You know, it's great to know Jesus, isn't it? I think everyone in here would agree. And it's not only just great to know him or know of him or know about him, but it is great to have Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior of your life. Amen. For those of us who have received him as Lord and Savior, we know how powerful that is, having him in our lives. Amen. And the thing about it is that it is not just a matter of having Jesus come into our heart so that one day we know our final destination, that we're going to heaven, and that we're going to miss being separated forever from the presence of God. We're not going that way if you've received Jesus Christ as your Savior. It is good to know that we have Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior of our life for our ultimate eternal destiny. But you know, we're still here today, aren't we? So it's not about just knowing Jesus for the other side of eternity, but we need to have Jesus in our lives for this side. Because God still has things for us to do, doesn't he? That we still have a will and a destiny and a purpose that God wants to work out while we're on this earth. You may or may not believe this, but there are people that are left for you to impact. And I'm saying that I don't care how old you are or how young you are. There is a destiny and a purpose for you. Amen. So it's good to know that Jesus is your Lord. But you know what? Even with Jesus Christ in our hearts, he himself said that there will be challenges, there will be trials, there will be tribulation in this earth for us. Amen. But he didn't leave us there. He didn't leave us in that mindset. Because he also said, though there will be issues that you have to deal with, he says that I've overcome the world. And the thing is, you need to be of good cheer because of that, but not only because I've overcome the world, but also because I have created in you the ability to overcome. Because I've left my Holy Spirit with you, and he's in you, and because of what you see me do, the same things you see me do, he has empowered us and enabled us to do those things. And that includes to overcome any and every situation that comes our way. We need to be excited about that. Amen. Now, there are some challenges that actually we can avoid or prevent. Sometimes we can actually pray and that there's an impending situation that's coming, we can have the power of prayer come upon us, and we can begin to intercede on our behalf and those who are close to us and that kind of thing. And you can actually sidestep. If you don't believe that, there were a lot of people praying for this area when Matthew came through here. Now, we had some damages, but for the most part, we avoided what could have been. We praise God for His grace and His mercy. I don't know about you. Amen. There were those who stayed and God preserved them, and there were those who left, but they had something to come back to when they came back. We need to give God some praise in this place. Hallelujah. But prayer can change the course of events.
Yes.
Okay. And the thing about it is that also, depending on our obedience, it can cause us to miss things.
Yes.
When we obey God and do what God tells us to do, it causes us to not face certain situations. But now I have to balance that, because our obedience to God can also get us in trouble. Because there are those who don't love it when we obey God. You might not believe it, but I got some witnesses in the Word of God. Because there were three Hebrew boys who obeyed God and said, O King Nebuchadnezzar, though you believe yourself to be a God, we serve the real Most High God.
Yes.
Amen. And we will not bow to you. So warm up your furnaces as hot as you can get them, because we will not bow. And not only that, O King, we're going to tell you something, that though you may heat up the furnaces and you want to put us in there, we serve a God who can deliver us, and He will. And not only that, not only did they have the furnaces turned up at the regular heat, but they turned it up 7 times hot. It was so hot that the people that tried to push them in there got burned up, didn't they? But when they went into the furnace, it was somebody already there. His name is Jesus. For even King Nebuchadnezzar said, I see a fourth man that I didn't put in there, and he looks like the Son of God. And the three Hebrew boys walked around, and though they were burning in the flame, not a stench of burn came upon them. But you see, you might be in your own fiery furnace. May not be fire, but it may be situations and circumstances that you're dealing with on your job. It may be circumstances and situations you're dealing in your own family. But God wants you to know that when you obey Him, that even though you may be in the fire, I'm going to bring you out of the fire. Come on now, praise Him. You see, when you obey God and get in trouble, then God is obligated to get you out. He ain't obligated to get you out when you disobey Him. But when you obey God and then you still run into trouble, God will move on your behalf. Amen. Daniel obeyed God. He prayed even though it was a law against prayer. We can learn something from that, because we get scared because we don't want to pray because people tell us we can't pray. But Daniel said, not only that, I'm going to open all my windows so y'all can see that I'm still going to pray, because I serve the Most High God that is able, that whatever situation I get in, to get me out. And they threw him in the lion's den. But you know, there were angels there to close the mouth of the lion. And guess what? You see, there was a rule called the law of equal test. That if the lion didn't eat the person they threw in originally, then the accusers had to go eat. Well, the angels kept the mouth of the lions closed, and so they were really hungry. They might have been hungry when Daniel went down there, but since they weren't able to eat him, when his accusers were thrown, before they even hit the ground, the lions ate them. Amen. And I'm telling you, some of you may be in your own lion's den. But I'm here to tell you that no matter what your situation and circumstance is, God has angels encamped around about you to keep you in your time of being in the lion's den.
Yes.
And we just came out of a storm. But I got news for you. If Jesus is in the boat with you, no matter what kind of storm you may have to deal with, you're coming out. And in that situation, Jesus had told his disciples, let us go to the other side. He did not say, let's go to the other side unless there's a storm that comes up. Unless there's a circumstance and a situation that comes up. He said, let us go. We got a mandate. We got stuff to do. But the storm came up. He was asleep. He was at peace. Well, he's the Prince of Peace, isn't he? Amen. That's where peace resides in Jesus. They woke him up and he said, peace be still. But if you're in your storm right now, I want you to know whatever that challenge is, whatever that test is, whatever it is you're having to endure, the Prince of Peace is in the boat with you. Amen. That's enough to shout about right there. Now, because we are dealing with so many things in this world, there is a challenge to our ability to believe the power of God. There are things that are going on every day that give us those challenges. Look at our social, political, and economic system. It is so crazy out there now. Because we have crazy politicians and crazy candidates acting crazy. But God wants you to know that he's still in charge. See, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, and the world and they that dwell therein. He says, the heart of the king is in the hand of the Lord, and I turn it whithersoever I will. Amen. So it does not matter who the president ultimately is. Jesus is still the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And our trust is not in the high office of the president, but in the Most High God. But these things challenge our belief system. Terrorism, both abroad and even here in this country, challenges our belief system. And let me tell you something. Terrorism is not just the act. It's not just the destruction. The terrorism is a mindset. So when nothing's going on, you still are in fear. That's the whole purpose of terrorizing folk. Even when nothing's going on, the mindset says something could happen if I go here. Something could happen if I do this. Terrorism, and it challenges our belief system. But I'm here today to tell you, amen, that God is here to let us know that terrorism, God has not given us the spirit of fear. Racial issues. I have to tell you, aside from the technology and social media, I never thought that 2016 would look like 1966. Come on, somebody. You know how it was then, those of you who have been around here long enough to know about it. But it seems as if what Jesus said is coming to pass. He said these things must take place. Racism, immorality, sexual and all other forms, everything that's an abomination against God, these things are coming in the earth. Amen. Things that would challenge our belief system. Because it seems like now the people who are operating in immorality are getting away with more and more and more and more, and nobody and nothing is being said about it. We have poverty and lack and debt and hunger and famine and sickness and disease everywhere. Now, this is not a message to discourage you, but I'm just giving you observations here. Amen. These things challenge our belief systems. And what frustrates me, I guess it's the nature of my ministry, is I hate to see the men and women of God, the prophets of the land, if you will, beginning to preach and teach and prophesy their personal preference rather than what thus saith the Lord. And God is not pleased with it. And there is judgment coming on those who persist to do that. People are more more political than they are prophetic. And you see, this is not just dangerous on one level, but actually two levels. It's dangerous because the world already believes that we're a bunch of hypocritical liars. And when leaders do that, they kind of prove their point. It's not the true church, but that's what they see. But the other side that's even more dangerous is the fact that you have lambs in the church, the young Christians. And when they see leadership doing this kind of stuff, it causes them to be disillusioned. And it causes them to rethink their decision for Jesus. And the next thing you know, they're not in the church anymore. And it's our fault, because leadership has been inconsistent in preaching the total and an unadulterated word of God. All of these things are happening. Amen. But this is the thing that we can still take solace in. Amen. That though these things are going on, we can still have peace. We can still believe what thus saith the Lord. And we're going to look in the scriptures today, and we're going to see a situation that will speak directly to us. Now, in verse 14, we see that Jesus saw his disciples and a great multitude about them, and the scribes questioning them. Before all this took place in the previous scriptures, Jesus was in a place called the Mount of Transfiguration. He went to pray, and he took three of his disciples with him. And when they got there and he began to pray, his raiment, his clothing became whiter than the whitest white. And then Moses and Elijah came and dialogued with Jesus. And Peter, James, and John were there. They didn't know what to do. They were frightened and all of this. And then after Moses and Elijah dialogued with Jesus, he left them. And then Jesus said, "Don't tell anybody what you saw." And then he began to come down off the mountain. And when Jesus looked in the distance, he saw a multitude questioning the other nine that were left. Very, very quickly, let me just make an observation that it seemed like Peter, James, and John spent the most time with Jesus. And you have to look at stuff like that, because it's not so much that Jesus was showing favoritism. But sometimes when God begins to show a leader what's in a person, sometimes they need a special attention, special training. And I say that to say that sometimes you might see people around men of God or women of God, and you might say, well, does he care about them, or does she care about them more than the rest? And it's not the case. But God has an assignment on that leader. When he sees or she sees what's in them, it's their responsibility to train them. And you need to know that, because sometimes you'll think that there's favoritism going on. Jesus certainly didn't favor anybody, because he spent all night praying to choose all 12 of them. Amen. So all 12 were important to him, but he dealt with those three. And then, you know, they ended up writing certain passages of scripture in the Bible. Amen. So God used them a certain way. But anyway, verse 15. Why do you question them? Jesus is saying, why? And one of the multitude answered and said, "Master, I brought unto thee my son, which hath a dumb spirit, and wheresoever he taketh him, he teareth him, he foams and gnashes his teeth, and pineth away, and I spake this to thy disciples, and they could not cast him out." And there's a lot going on there. First you say, well, didn't Jesus already know what the situation was? Amen. Well, that's not what is at issue here. Because Jesus, like any great counselor, and he's the wonderful counselor, Jesus asked questions, not necessarily so much because of what he doesn't know, but he wants to know if you know what your situation is. See, that's the problem many times. We don't probe enough to find out what the issue is so you can pray about it. And then if you don't get people to talk to you and let you know what the situation is, you can't really help them as effectively. So Jesus, being the wonderful counselor, understood this kind of thing. Now, just to let you know, Jesus can sometimes know what the situation is and still ask questions. There was a Samaritan woman at the well, and the first thing Jesus says to her is, "Where is your husband?" Now, Jesus knew the entire situation, but he needed to elicit from her some truth so that she would be in a position for him to be able to help her. Amen. And so it's not so much that Jesus doesn't necessarily know. It's a matter that he is a person that's going to ask you questions to make sure you know. He's going to ask questions to see how much pride you have, if you're going to tell the whole truth about a situation. And when you're able to do that, when you're able to be transparent, then Jesus is able to help. Amen. He said to blind Bartimaeus, who shouted him down, "Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me." And the disciples kept saying, "Shut up. Leave the master alone." But Jesus stopped. And when Bartimaeus came to him, now Jesus could look at this man and see what his situation was, what couldn't he? But he said, "What do you want me to do? I want you to tell me." See how it works? That's what prayer is all about. Is Jesus said, God says in his word, "I already know what your situation is. I already know what you have need of." But he says, ask. That's what prayer is about, because it's not what that God doesn't know what the situation is, but sometimes maybe you don't know. And maybe sometimes you need to speak that thing out. Amen. But see, now some people will argue and say, and I've said this, you shouldn't speak the problem. But see, this is the situation. There's a difference between speaking it so that you know what it is and dwelling on it. It's not a matter of analyzing what the problem is. It is a matter of not dwelling on it and allowing it to take you down. So Jesus questioned what was going on. His father told him what the demonic spirit was doing. And then Jesus said, "Oh, faithless generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I suffer you? Bring him unto me." Now, when you hear that, it sounds like Jesus is a little bit irritated. But you have to understand that Jesus loves people. But Jesus hates faithlessness. Jesus hates the works of the devil. So sometimes if the preacher gets a little indignant, it's not a matter that they're preaching at you. It's because they're angry at what the devil is doing in the midst of God's people. So it says, "Bring him to me." He brought him to him. He saw him, and straightway the spirit tear him, and he fell down at the ground and wallowing foam. Now it's very interesting that the same thing he was always doing, he did it in Jesus' presence for the time being. Okay. But you see, sometimes when you see certain situations, it scares us. Our belief system is shattered because of what we see. And so he did the same thing with Jesus. And Jesus asked an interesting question, which we're going to deal with. Jesus says, "How long is it ago since this came unto him?" And his father said, "Of a child." Now watch this. The devil is not waiting until your child grows up to be an adult to attack. And I got news for you, he ain't waiting until high school, and now he's not waiting until middle school. Your elementary school child is being attacked by the devil. And I'm here to tell you, you better start praying over your child in the womb. You better lay your hands on that stomach and decree and declare what God is going to do in the life of that child. You better plead the blood of Jesus over your child. Amen. Because the devil is not waiting until they grow up. He's starting young. Let me tell you something. The devil is having the teachers in your schools, and you better monitor what your child is learning, because they're teaching them occult stuff, and it's teaching them things that God calls an abomination. They think they're making my two dads and my two moms acceptable to them at an early age. They're getting picked on. They're getting bullied. All of these different things are happening to your child early. The devil is not waiting. Amen. And so he asked him, how long? You see, even your child is being exposed to things like Harry Potter. Now it's quiet, and I understand why. But you see, yeah, Reverend Miller, you go this way, but you see, I tell you these things not to try to be a spoil sport, but you see, it's because I love you. And the thing about that is, I can love you but not necessarily care what you think. Because if I start caring what you think, I'll start backing away from telling you the truth. And see, the thing about it is, if I back off, then you might be pleased, but somebody else is not going to be pleased. And I think I care about pleasing him a little bit more than you, because you didn't die on the cross for me. So I'm telling you, see, when you say things like exposing your kids to Harry Potter, oh, Reverend, that's just, you know, they're just harmless books. Very interesting books. That's just harmless movies. Uh-huh. But then there's always spells and incantations and all of these things. And then those who are skeptical about what I'm saying, you watch your once completely and totally obedient child, all of a sudden they're disobedient. All of a sudden they're rebellious. All of a sudden they're lethargic. All of a sudden you're wondering what's going on. It's because of the occult stuff that they're getting exposed to. They got a movie called Ouija Board coming out. I remember that. But see, when you start asking questions of the board and asking questions essentially of the devil instead of going to the Holy Ghost, you're on dangerous ground. And I might as well keep going. If you're governing your life by the stars, you're in danger. Because that's a cult. And you might not like it because you're a Gemini, you're a Scorpio, or whatever you think you are. But your life is not run by the stars. Now, Pastor, they're going to say, you know, we might not invite him back. But the thing about it is, you can't really get rid of me because I'm going to be here anyway, whether I'm preaching or not. So I might as well tell y'all the truth. Come on here. But see, our children are being exposed to this stuff. And that's why things are happening. So when Jesus asked him that, we find that it's been a while, which gets back to the question, how long? Our belief system is challenged by the length of time something takes to happen. See, this father had watched his child, his precious child who's close to him, go through all these gyrations, and it hurt him. He felt hopeless and helpless. But this had been a long time coming. But I have to ask you, look, what's your situation that seems hopeless, that caused you to be in a helpless position, and how long has it been? How long have you been dealing with a health situation? How long have you been dealing with a financial situation? How long have you been dealing with a family situation? How long have you waited for your son or your daughter to come to know Jesus? It's been a while, but you've been giving up because there's a challenge to your belief system. Jesus said, how long? I'm here to tell you, it doesn't matter how long, because Jesus was getting ready to remedy the situation. But I know that there's a lot of you out there that are looking at your situation, and it's been a while, and you about to throw in the towel. In fact, some of you have said, there's no use even pursuing it, because it's never going to happen. But if you can believe. The father went on to tell Jesus what happened. Sometimes he's thrown in the water and thrown in the fire. Can you imagine watching your child have that happen? And you always having to go grab him, pull him out of the fire, pull him. That's a serious situation. And I imagine whatever you might be dealing with is a very serious situation. Amen. And Jesus, and he told Jesus that. And then he the man said, after he said that, and this is, watch this. He said, this is going on, and then I called on your disciples and they couldn't help him. He says to Jesus, if you can do anything, help us. Now watch this. Never try to determine what God is able to do based on what some man is not able to do. I don't care if he did walk with Jesus, he wasn't Jesus. And then he was in training with Jesus. But see, you can't say because the pastor prayed or your favorite television evangelist prayed or whoever it is prayed and it didn't happen, that has nothing to do with God's ability. That's why our faith must be in God. And if God happens to use an individual, praise him. But ultimately, we trust in God. And so this man, and I don't believe he's trying to be disrespectful, but basically he said, your boys can do it. So can you? What can you do? And Jesus put the onus back on him. He said, if you can believe, all, A-L-L, not some, not most. See, you need to know that your situation is included in all. I don't care how impossible it seems at all, or how long you've dealt with it. Jesus said, if you can believe, all things are possible. See, this is a word that God wants to drum in your spirit. All things are possible. You say it's not based on the statistics, based on the education, based on what your financial situation is, based on what your doctor said or whatever the case is. I don't care how long. If you can believe, that means if you can have faith, if you can trust or entrust anything that you have in the hands of God, if you can't believe, all things are possible. Do you believe that today? Do you believe it? Because what's going to have to happen, and I'm almost done, so what's going to have to happen is we're going to have to get to a place where we begin to meditate on what God's word says. Because you see, the word is in competition with the world. And the world is bringing all kinds of distraction through the television, through the radio, through the internet, that's diametrically opposed to what God's word says. And we pay more attention to that than what the word of God says. Amen. We are instructed to meditate on God's word day and night. But anyway, Jesus said, if you can believe, all things are possible. And the man says this, and he's honest, and I think he's on the street where most of us are. The man said, I believe. Help thou my unbelief. Now what he's really saying is, I have a certain level of belief, but I'm not all in. There's some doubt that I still have. Even though you tell me you can do this, I want to believe you fully, but there's doubt in my heart. Many of us are there. That's not a condemnation, that's an observation. But we need to understand that we are just that close to a miracle when we eliminate doubt. The scriptures tell us that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt, but shall believe, he shall have whatsoever he says. So doubt can come because we have things that divide our attention away from the word of God. So he said, I'm not there. I don't fully believe. I'm being honest. And Jesus said, okay, I can work with you there. Now the thing about it is, Jesus can work with us there, but he doesn't want us to stay there. He wants us to meditate on God's word and get to a point that we begin to eliminate doubt. Jesus began to rebuke the spirit. Spirit cried out, and he had no choice but to go because Jesus said, it's time for you to leave now. You've been with this child for a long time. And I want to encourage you today, even as we get ready to close this message today, that I don't care what your situation is. I don't care how long you've dealt with it. Jesus says it's time now. If you stand on the word of God, if you choose to believe God today, the end of your situation is near. If you can believe, all things are possible to him that believeth. Now you got to do a couple of things. As we just said, you need to meditate. Joshua was instructed to meditate on the word day and night. That means constantly feed your spirit with the word of God. If you're in fear, you need some fear scriptures. God has not given me the spirit of fear, but a power and love of a sound mind. You're dealing with finances, you got to understand that my God shall supply all my need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. And if you don't get doubt out the first time you read it 10 more times. And if it ain't out then, read it 100 times. Meditate on a single scripture. You ain't got to go all over the Bible. Yes, you need to do some daily Bible reading and meditation. But if you're in a situation, get some scriptures that apply to your situation and meditate on that thing until it becomes something that you don't mentally assent to, and it goes down into your spirit where you believe it without doubt. Got to up the prayer time. Because the more prayer you do, the greater your faith comes. Amen. And we need to do those things. And living a lifestyle that's pleasing to God has something to do with that too. Amen. Don't discount that. Because God can move in our lives when we live according to his precepts and his example. If you can believe, all things are possible to him that believeth. Amen. Give God praise. Give him honor and give him glory. Now the word is going forth, and I believe that it is a deposit. And now we have something that's just as important at this time. Because God wants everybody in here to know his son Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior. It's critical, especially in these days. So if there is one today, or two, or five, or ten, or however, if you have not really made Jesus Christ the Lord and Savior of your life, this is your time. If that's you, you could raise your hands, no pressure. But if you know that if you left this earth in the next 5 minutes, you're not sure whether you'd be with him. Amen. It's not how long you've been in the church. It's not how long you've been in the choir. It's not how long you've served. But do you have a relationship with Jesus?